Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. So the topic that we will discuss today is diabetes mellitus. Since this is a vast topic, therefore it has been divided into various parts. Each part will be covered in separate videos. So the parts that we will cover in this topic are introduction, classification, pathogenesis, various clinical features that are observed in diabetes mellitus, complications of diabetes mellitus, and lastly, the pharmacological aspects of diabetes mellitus. So, in today's part, we will cover the introduction of diabetes mellitus. So, coming to the introduction of diabetes mellitus. What is diabetes mellitus? Diabetes mellitus is a group of metabolic disorders having the features of hyperglycemia. So what is hyperglycemia? Hyperglycemia means increased levels of glucose in the blood. Now, how is the amount of glucose in the blood regulated? It is regulated mainly by two hormones, which are insulin and glucagon. Insulin is secreted by the beta cells of the islets of Langerhans, and the glucagon is released by the alpha cells of the islets of Langerhans. So what is the function of insulin? Insulin distributes the glucose from the blood to the tissues. So it helps in the uptake of glucose from the blood into the tissues, thereby maintaining the blood glucose level. So now if there is any deficiency in the insulin level, what will happen is that the reuptake of glucose from the blood to the tissues will decrease, as a result of which the glucose level in the blood will increase, resulting in hyperglycemia. So any defect in insulin production, or due to some reason, if there is any deficiency in the levels of insulin, it will result in hyperglycemia. We will see subsequently it in the causes of diabetes mellitus. So, diabetes mellitus is a group of metabolic disorders having features of hyperglycemia. So, to know the increased levels of glucose in the blood, first of all, we have to know what are the normal blood glucose levels. So, coming to the normal blood glucose levels, the fasting blood glucose level in a normal person is less than 100 milligram per deciliter. So, what is this fasting blood glucose level? Suppose a person is told to do overnight fasting, and then in the next day his blood glucose level is measured. So here, after doing overnight fasting, the blood glucose level which is being measured, it is the fasting blood glucose level. So normally it has to be less than 100 milligram per deciliter. Next criteria which is seen is the glucose level following OGTT. Now what is OGTT? OGTT is oral glucose tolerance test. So here the glucose level is normally less than 140 milligram per deciliter. Now what is this OGTT? In OGTT means in oral glucose tolerance test, what is done is the person is given a standard carbohydrate load of 75 gram of glucose. After giving this load of 75 gram of glucose, after 2 hours the glucose level is being measured. So this is the glucose level following OGTT. So in a normal person, it has to be less than 140 milligram per deciliter. Next criteria for measuring the normal blood glucose level is to see at the HbA1c level. Now what is this HbA1c? HbA1c refers to glycosylated hemoglobin. Now what is glycosylated hemoglobin? What happens is, there is non-enzymatic attachment of glucose to the globin chain of hemoglobin. We know that hemoglobin comprises of two chains, the hemoglobin comprises of two parts, the heme and the globin. So the glucose non-enzymatically binds to the globin component of hemoglobin. So this is the glycosylated hemoglobin. So what is the normal HbA1c level? The normal HbA1c level is less than 5.6 milligram per deciliter. So these are the criteria for normal blood glucose level. Now we will see the impaired glucose tolerance. It is also known as the pre-diabetic condition. Yes, it is also known as the pre-diabetic condition. Means in this condition, the person has more tendency to move towards the diabetic condition. So it is the pre-diabetic condition. Now, how to diagnose that it is a pre-diabetic condition? So in this condition, the fasting blood glucose level will be greater than 100 milligram per deciliter, but it will be less than 126 milligram per deciliter. The glucose level following OGTT, about which we had mentioned earlier, the oral glucose tolerance test, it will be between 140 milligram per deciliter and 199 milligram per deciliter. The random plasma glucose level will also be between 140 milligram per deciliter and 199 milligram per deciliter. And the HbA1c level, that means the glycosylated hemoglobin level, will be between 5.7 to 6.4%. One thing to be mentioned, the glycosylated hemoglobin gives a measure of the glucose level for the average glucose level for 3 months. Because we know the lifespan of RBCs is 120 days. And here the glucose non-enzymatically binds with the globin part of the hemoglobin present in RBC. So it will give an average measure of the blood glucose level for the whole span of the RBC, that is for 120 days. So on an average, it gives a measure of the RBC of around 3 months. So this is about the criteria for impaired glucose tolerance. Now finally, we will see the diabetic condition. When will we say that a person is diabetic? So we will say a person is diabetic if the fasting blood glucose level is 126 milligram per deciliter or more than that. If the glucose level following the OGTT is 200 milligram per deciliter or more than that. Similarly, the random plasma glucose level is, if it is 200 milligram per deciliter or more than that, then also we will say that the person is diabetic. And lastly, if the HbA1c level is more than 6.5%, then also the person is said to be diabetic. Now one thing has to be noted, that the measurements for blood glucose level here has to be done in two separate occasions. Because the first time while we were measuring the blood glucose level, maybe due to certain conditions like stress or infection, due to high catecholamine release, maybe the blood glucose level may be raised. So to avoid such errors, the blood glucose level has to be measured in two separate occasions. So these are the criteria for the diabetic condition. So this is all about the introduction of diabetes mellitus, and the subsequent parts will be covered in the subsequent videos. Thank you.